Okay, so hope there won't be any glitches in between. So thank you, Jaya, for inviting me. And yeah, when Jaya called me, I could not say no to her. That's why today we are having some exam duty. So maybe I may not be able to justify my invitation, but I tried my level best to make it as simple as possible. But you can ask me or question me at any time if you have some doubt. So I would like to be this be in an interactive mode. So if there is any breaking or anything, please let me know. This my screen is in full screen mode. So if you put in chat, I won't be able to see. So please unmute yourself and ask or tell me. So shall I start?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, okay. Sure.
Yeah. So good morning, everyone. So today I want to discuss with you about how stars evolve and what are the stars' contribution to our life when they evolve. So my as you guys can see on my screen, my topic is we are made of stardust and what is their role in what is the role of stars during their evolution and nucleosynthesis of elements. So you know that chemical elements are integral part of our life. Like all the material near you are made of some or other elements. The water you drink, the food you eat, or the any material you use is made of one or other elements. Even our body contains at least 25 elements in various proportions. This is the periodic table, the recent periodic table. Do you know how many elements are there in the periodic table now? You can see on my screen if it is visible. Or if you know, please tell me how many elements are there in the periodic table now? Am I audible or you are not talking?
No, actually, Drisha, if you ask some questions, they won't be able to answer since the host has to unmute them.
180. Oh, okay. Sorry. Okay, then I'll carry on. So we have 118 elements in the periodic table, out of which 94 elements are naturally occurring. Today I want to discuss how these natural elements, these 94 natural elements are produced. Or what are the physical conditions at which they are produced, or whether we can make them by in our laboratory, or they are made somewhere else and transported to our earth. And another question I would like to address is, are they produced during the Big Bang? Hope you might have heard about Big Bang. Big Bang, and so we believe that our universe has created.
Okay.
So we believe that our universe has created from a single huge explosion called the Big Bang explosion. So I want to see, I want to check whether these elements are produced during the Big Bang. Now, actually, the understanding of the production mechanism of this element started very long back. So in 1925, people realized that stars are made of hydrogen and helium. This led to people think that there are some connection between the origin or the production of these elements and the stars. But in 1957, a person, Margaret Burbidge, she proposed that all the elements, all the natural elements are produced by stars. Now, that means we are like all the elements are produced by stars means whatever you are seeing is the a remnant of some stars, or it came from stars. So here you can see our solar system. The solar system means our Earth is also included. In the solar system, you can say this periodic table shows the solar system abundances of elements color-coded according to the production mechanism of their or the origin of the elements. So here you can see that this blue color, hydrogen, helium, and a small amount of lithium are of course produced during the Big Bang nucleosynthesis. So they are the first elements produced during the Big Bang. The rest of the elements, so some elements are produced by low mass stars. I will define low mass and high mass at the end. So some elements are produced by low mass stars, some elements are produced by high mass stars. So here orange color indicates, I will explain all this, but orange and green color indicates the elements produced by massive stars, and the yellow one is low mass stars. So that means finally it is confirmed that we are made of stardust. So that is interesting, right? We have our body is made of from the stars. So let me see how it is possible. So before that, I would like to introduce how stars evolve. So as I already told, I have defined stars, the elements are produced either by low mass stars or high mass stars. Here I define the low mass stars as stars with mass between 0.8 to 8 times the mass of the sun. And stars above 8 solar mass are defined as high mass stars. So this is the life cycle of a star. Like us, like we, nammal jenikkum pinne marikkum adhe pole stars also, they evolve through different stages and finally end their life. But these stages they pass through depend upon some their mass or some of the elements in that when they are born. So for low mass stars, see, when the star is born from this stellar nebulae is nothing but this is molecular cloud of dust and gas. So stars are produced or formed when this molecular cloud collapses under its own gravity. So planets are also formed in this way, but when nuclear synthetic reaction or energy production starts, the body is classified to be as a star or otherwise as a planet. So when the star is born, either as low mass or high mass, when low mass stars passes through red giant stage, then planetary nebulae, and finally end their life as a white dwarf. But in the case of high mass stars, it will go to red supergiant stage and finally explode as a supernova. Then it will go as a neutron star or as a black hole. So let us see little bit details about this evolution. So when the star is born, usually we study this star's evolution after locating them in a plane called HR diagram. HR diagram is nothing but it is the graph connecting luminosity. Luminosity is nothing but the energy output, or the simpler words, you can consider it as a brightness, or it's not exactly the brightness, but for understanding, you can consider it as a brightness, and then surface temperature. So here you can see that when the star is born, most of the stars are located in this diagonal region, and this is called the main sequence. So first stage of evolution of any star, both massive and high mass star, is in the main sequence. A star spent most of its time in this diagonal region called the main sequence. So the maximum lifespan of a star, maybe the star depends upon the mass, star has billions of years of life, or maybe few million years also. So anyway, the first stage is main sequence. Then you can see that our sun is somewhere here down, and massive stars are here. And after this, when the star is in main sequence, as I already told at the beginning, the star is collapsing, continuous collapse is there, but there should be some energy production to counterbalance the collapse. So this is given by, the energy is given by some nuclear reaction inside the stars. In the main sequence, it is the hydrogen burning in the core of the star is the main energy source. So since stars are made of mainly hydrogen, so there are enough amount of hydrogens to spend billions of years on the main sequence. So once this hydrogen is exhausted or finished, I cannot say it is finished. So some part it is reduced, what will happen? It will go to the next stage of evolution called the giant stage. But here, hydrogen is finished, but what will happen? So there is no energy production. So what will, the core will continue to collapse. But during this collapse, what the temperature of the core increases. So what will happen? There will be a hydrogen burning layer. This is the star's core. If you are, you can assume this is the core. And so there will be a hydrogen burning shell. So when the core heats up, it will heat the, just above the layers also heated up along with the core. So hydrogen started to burning in a shell outside the hydrogen exhausted core. So as I already told, hydrogen burning is already occurred in the core. So what will be the product? There will be some helium left over in the core, and there is a hydrogen burning shell. So this stage is called the giant stage. So the initial stage, so subgiant stage, we call this as a subgiant stage. So again, whole process continues. This energy is not enough to counterbalance the collapse. So star continues to collapse and core heats up. So finally, what will happen? The star moves slightly upwards, and when star reaches at the tip of this giant stage, what will happen? The core heat will reach around 10 raised to 8 Kelvin. That time, I told there are some helium. Helium starts to burning. So when the star reaches this tip of this giant stage, helium is the main source of energy. So that means, so this and all you should remember, because I want to tell how these elements are produced during these stages. So when the stars are in the giant stage, helium is the main energy source. Finally, similar to hydrogen, helium also will exhaust. What will happen? The process will continue and the star will start to burning, collapse. So there will be two shells generated, like one hydrogen burning shell already created at the previous stage, and next is the helium burning shell. Now it is, it starts burning next. So the when the star when the helium exhausts, the star has two shell structure. So one is hydrogen burning shell and another is helium burning shell. Now in more, this stage is called the asymptotic giant branch stage of stars. Till this point, the evolution of both low mass as well as high mass stars are same. Most of the low mass stars end their life as an asymptotic giant stage. So that means it has only two burning shells. But for the high mass stars, what will happen? Whole process continues. Helium burning, next the carbon will start burning. So many, many burning shells will be created. So this is called an onion structure of a star. So this will happen only in the case of a massive star. So these are the main difference. Low mass star end their life at the AGB stage, then go to white dwarf stage. But high mass stars go to next heavy stages and finally explode as a supernovae and end their life as neutron star or black holes. Now, this is the normal evolution of a star. Now, let us see how the elements are produced during this process. So, as I already told, first process when the star is in the main sequence is the hydrogen burning. So, in the case of stars, low mass star or high mass star, when the star's mass is around 1.5 times the sun's mass, the hydrogen burning occurs only by proton-proton cycle. Proton-proton cycle is nothing but just two hydrogen atom combine and some process, then helium-3 will be formed. Again, some reactions will occur. Finally, helium-4 is produced. This is called proton-proton chain. So at this stage, you can see that some amount of helium are produced, some deuterium are produced, some tritium are produced. So these are very smaller quantities, but still some elements are contributed when the stars are in the main sequence. But in the case of stars with mass higher than 2 solar mass, what will happen? The hydrogen burning will occur as by CNO cycle. CNO cycle is nothing but it is, there are some, so I told stars are made from, or stars are born from the molecular cloud. So there are some amount of carbon, nitrogen or oxygen in that molecular cloud. So these elements, what will happen? These elements will activate the hydrogen burning. The final product is anyway helium only, but in between you can see some elements like some isotopes of nitrogen, oxygen are produced during when the CNO cycle is happening. Again, depends upon the mass, or now we know that 2 solar mass, if the mass is slightly above 3 solar mass, there are some branching. I hope you might have studied in chemistry, like there are some branching reactions. So depends upon the temperatures, there are some branching reaction activated. In that case, some other elements like beryllium, some amount of lithium, some other elements, boron, are produced during this process. So now we know, like during main sequence, elements up to beryllium, boron, or carbon, nitrogen, oxygen are produced when the stars are in the main sequence. Also, I told when the star reaches the end of the RGB stage, helium is the main source. So this helium burning produces, again, the main product is carbon-12. So that is this carbon-12 is the main base of our life, right? Carbon is the main element responsible for life. That's why it is called we are made of stardust. Now, then further elements like hydrogen, I told after hydrogen burning, helium burning, then massive stars, other burning like carbon burning, oxygen burning, neon burning will occur. And other elements, all elements like heavy elements like magnesium, silicon, sulfur, argon, all these elements are also produced inside the stars, but only in the case of massive stars. And finally, iron also can be produced. Till iron can be produced by this kind of fusion reactions inside the stars. But what about other elements? So we have other elements like gold, silver, platinum, all these are from stars only. But how did these elements are formed? So these elements, so we know that iron is the most stable element. You might have already studied. So iron is the most stable element. It has maximum binding energy per nucleon. So fusion reactions of iron are not possible. So what will happen? We cannot fuse iron. So how do we make other elements? For that, there are another process called neutron capture process. It is nothing but an isotope will capture a neutron. Why neutron? So we told iron is the most stable element. So charged particle reactions are not possible. But here, charged particle reaction won't be happening because neutron is chargeless. So we can add neutron. So if we add one neutron, what will happen? Next isotope will be formed, right? Atomic number will be same, but mass number will increase. So finally, the elements above heavier than iron can be produced by neutron capture process. There are mainly two neutron capture process. One is slow neutron capture process. And that means from the name itself, you can understand slow neutron capture process is very slow. So it will capture one neutron and then beta decay to next heavy element. And another reaction is the rapid neutron capture process. In this case, what will happen? Multiple neutrons will be added or captured. Then beta decay into what will happen when an isotope beta decay, its atomic number increases. So we'll get next heavier element. And this reaction requires two entirely different astrophysical sites and conditions. And the elements produced by these two neutron capture processes are also different. The slow neutron capture process will occur, or the condition is satisfied in the case of a low mass stars when these stars are at the AGB stage. So you remember AGB stage is a final stage. So slow neutron capture process also occur when in the low mass stars at AGB stage, and the elements produced are strontium, yttrium, zirconium, barium, lanthanum, and finally the lead also will be produced by low mass stars by slow neutron capture process. But rapid neutron capture process is require very extreme conditions, like very high temperature of the order of 10 raised to 11 Kelvin and neutrons, very high neutron density of the order of 10 raised to 23 neutrons per centimeter cube. So this can occur only at exotic conditions like black hole merging events or a neutron star or some kind of that kind of very rare events. So the elements produced are like also exotic, like thorium, silver, gold, platinum. So you might have understood why gold is so precious or why platinum is so costly. So this will occur only during the very rare events of black hole merging events or that kind of very rare events. And this even the production itself is rare, and the event rate, that is, this black hole will be produced very rarely. So that's why these elements are also very rare. Now let me tell you, now we know what the elements are produced inside the stars, but how do we understand how these elements are produced? Or these are all theory, right? But we observationally, we need to confirm this results. So these elements are present in the star. So these elements are the reason for all the material. These elements are coming from the star, but how do we understand that? How do we determine what are the elements present in the stars and how it reaches Earth? For that, we use some observational studies. So here what we do, we combine astrophysics with spectroscopy. So I don't know whether you have studied spectroscopy. It is maybe some part you might have studied. Spectroscopy is the splitting of light and we can see the spectra. So what we do, we combine the stars, we split light from the stars into the constituent. So from that we can understand these elements are there. So the astronomical spectroscopy is the most important tool to identify or understand all the properties of the stars. So from the spectra, we can understand the temperature, density, even we can identify what is the velocity of the star, and we even can identify the age of a star, and we can identify the magnetic field or any magnetic field is present in the stars. Or what any physical condition, even some planets we are studying using. So there are many planets discovered now. So we are using astronomical spectroscopy to understand the nature of the stars or the planets. So it's nothing but the splitting of starlight. And we know that different stars have different composition. So each spectra, so one the spectra of each stars differ. So the spectral lines produced by each substances present in the star as also will be different. So let me briefly explain what do I mean by this spectroscopy. So you know that I think you might have studied this. So when a starlight fall on a prism, it will split into different colors. So in this case, you can see that it's just light passed through the vacuum. There is no substances present. So we get a continuous spectra here. But what will happen if I keep some substances here? some substance, I am keeping some substances here. What will happen? The light will pass through that substance. So that means there are, so some amount of substance. So for example, I am keeping some glass of water in between the or on the way of the starlight. So what will happen? There are water molecules. They absorb some amount of light. So what will happen? When they absorb some amount of light, they will shift their energy levels. So you might have already studied hydrogen atom energy levels and all. So there will be Balmer lines or any Lyman lines, or these are produced when the hydrogen atom absorbs some amount of energy and move to next stage. Then it can emit, and absorption can also happen. It can emit. So there are two types of spectra. When the substance absorbs the light, we will get an absorption spectra. So we get background continuum light. There will be some dark lines. These are called absorption spectra. But if some substance can go to higher energy level and then come back, so we can get emission spectra. So here you can see the example when I keep some neon or magnesium, calcium, hydrogen or so, any substance, you can see that we get some emission spectra. So here you see there are differences. When I keep neon, the lines are different. When I keep magnesium, the lines are different. This is exactly same as stars also, right? Star surface, we can see many elements. Maybe some stars magnesium will be more, some stars strontium will be more. So it depends upon the elements present, we will get different kinds of spectra. So these are different kinds of spectra. So when the substance we keep, it is a cold or a temperature is not high, we get an absorption spectra. If we have the star is very hot or hot substance, we get an emission spectra. If there is nothing, we will get a continuous spectra. And I hope you might have heard about Wien's displacement law. So you know that the stars emit light or at different wavelength, depends upon the temperature of the star. If the temperature is very high, the stars emit at UV wavelength. If the star is very cold, it will be in infrared light. So that means stars emit light at different wavelength. So we have to collect this light at Earth, from the Earth. So for that, we need telescopes, right? We have to collect this light from the Earth. So for that, we use different kinds of telescope. So some telescope is specifically designed to collect light from in the UV light. So that means they can be used to observe only stars at very high temperature, and some stars emit infrared. So we will be having some infrared telescope to collect those stars, light from those stars. But the problem is our Earth, we cannot detect all wavelength. So visible light, okay, normal light we can detect. So this is called an observational window. So you can see that, let us see this is an Earth atmosphere. We can see that Earth atmosphere can collect all the visible light if the telescope is kept some height or some on the top of a mountain. So that's why most of the telescopes are found at the mountain. So when we can collect all the visible light, but very high energy UV, X-ray, we cannot collect from the Earth. For that, we use space telescopes. So you might have heard NASA is spending many space telescopes. So Hubble, JWST, many space telescopes are there. So we can collect those light only using space telescope. That means hot object. This hot object means most of the massive stars will be hot. So they can be studied, or this black holes, neutron star, all this can be studied using space telescope. But visible light, so low mass stars, we can study from the Earth. But some amount of infrared is also blocked by Earth's atmosphere. So we need space telescopes for infrared telescopes also. But radio waves are very longer wavelength, so we can detect even at the ground level. So that means you might have heard we have many radio telescopes in India, one in Ooty, one in Mumbai. So they can be collected from the Earth atmosphere. So once we have these space telescopes or a ground-based telescope, we can study the stars. But another problem is, stars have different brightness or different magnitudes. So some are very faint, and some, even though they are bright, they may be at very large distance. So what we need? We need very big telescope. So usually for amateur telescopes makers, we'll be using maximum by 1 meter telescope. But to study this star, we need very high, very large diameter telescope, minimum 4 meter telescope. For faint stars, we need at least 10 meter, 20 meter class telescopes. And also, thus we need to study the spectra of the star to understand their properties. So the spectral lines should be resolved. For that, we need very high resolving power for the telescope. That's why these telescopes are very costly to construct. So we have very few telescopes all over the world. And also, telescopes need, now one science case I told, we need to study the chemical properties or physical properties of the star. But if we need, telescopes will only collect the light. But what, depend upon the science case we want to study, we need some more instruments. We need, if you want just to study the structure of a star, we need just to take a photo. For that, we need an imager. Image just the source of light, or stars or planets are imaged through imager. Then we need a photometers. Photometer means if we want to count the light coming, you know, light means nothing but the photons. So we want to count, we are using photometers. And another, and this already I told, this is spectrograph for splitting of light. So for spectra, we need spectrograph. For to collect the photons, to understand the energy, we need photometers. Just to take the photo, we need only imager. Now, since we are only in, now today I'm telling only about the spectrograph, how the spectra will be obtained. So I'm telling only the basic spectrograph design. So this is the basic spectrograph design. This is the telescope's mirror. It will collect the light. Then what will it do? It will send the light to a slit. Slit, why we use slit is that we are focusing the telescopes to sky. There are many sources, many stars. So even though we know the exact location of the star, there will be some nearby star. So what we need, we make the slit width very small so that the background will be eliminated. And once the starlight passes through this slit, it will go to a collimator. Then it will go to, we need to split, right, light. For that, in astronomical spectro, this telescope, we don't use prism. We used grating. So grating means it is similar to prism. It's nothing but we are ruling the lines over a glass plane, or mostly reflection grating are used. And depends on the number of grating and number of grating lines. We need very high resolution, very high splitter spectra. And then it will go to a camera to focus. And finally, it will be focused on the detector. Here we use a CCD. Earlier photographic plates were used. Nowadays, we are using a detector. And these are just, I have summarized whatever I told. So finally, what we will get, this is a solar spectra. We get many lines. Sun has many lines. So we get many spectral lines. This is very high resolution spectra. That's why even small chunks are wavelength. Like this is from 3000 to 10,000. So some chunks like 3000. So you might have heard different orders will be coming when grating is, when the light passes through grating, first order, second order. So these are different order spectra. We get spectral lines. And finally, we have some softwares to do this. What we will do, we convert these spectra into this form so that we have different lines. Now see, some lines are shown here. Sodium is shown here. Oxygen lines are shown here. Some lines are shown. So there are different lines here. we measure the strength of these lines. From this strength, we can understand the elements present, the temperature at which they are produced, different properties of the stars. Or same thing can be applied to planet, but planet won't emit light. So what we will do, the star light will be reflected by the planet. That light we will collect and study this using spectrograph. And I'm stopping my presentation. These are some of the very high, large diameter telescopes we used for this type of studies. And these are at different, located at different places. Some are in the Chile, US, or some are in Japan, some are in South Africa. Depends upon the stars we need to study, because stars are located at different places. So we need different telescopes at different locations, and we use these kind of telescopes to study the stars. Even in India now, we have two telescopes, one in IAA, 2 meter VBO, and also 2 meter Himalayan Chandra telescope. And also in Aries Nainital, we have 3.6 meter telescope. So you can see their website to understand the properties of and the science case they are trying to study. So I hope I can stop here. You can ask me if you have some doubts. So I have just given a flavor of what is happening in this astronomical spectroscopy and stellar evolution. This is a very big subject, but I just tried to conclude or make it very small. So I may not be able to tell everything clearly. So if you have some doubt, you can ask me.
Those who have anything to ask, please raise your hands.
I think they are in the months like on it.
No, Anganella. അവര് ഈ അൺമ്യൂട്ട് മ്യൂട്ട് ചെയ്യുന്ന ഒരു പ്രോസസ് കുറച്ച് ടെക്നിക്കലി ബുദ്ധിമുട്ടാണ്, അതിന്റെ ഒരു ബുദ്ധിമുട്ടിലാണെന്ന്
തോന്നുന്നു.
പ്ലീസ് യു കെൻ എന്റർ ഇൻ ദി ചാറ്റ് ബോക്സ് ഓൾസോ ഓർ ജസ്റ്റ് റേസ് യുവർ ഹാൻഡ് വിൽ അൺമ്യൂട്ട് യു.
ഇന്റർനെറ്റ് ഇൻ ബിറ്റ്വീൻ പോയോ?
ഇല്ല ഇല്ല, നോ പ്രോബ്ലം, ഇന്റർനെറ്റ് വാസ് ഓക്കെ. I don't think anyone has anything to talk, anything to ask you.
Okay.
Okay. Aisha?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, thank you so much. Thank you so much. We were able to grasp some new information. Thank you so much. So now I call upon Devadatta of second year physics to propose the vote of thanks.
Good afternoon to one and all. I deem it a great honor to propose the vote of thanks for today's webinar. First of all, I would like to thank our distinguished speaker, Dr. Drishya Ma'am, for making excellent presentations and making this webinar interesting and meaningful. Thank you, ma'am. Next, I would like to express our profound gratitude to our HOD, Dr. Jaya TP, and other teachers to our department for their moral support and guidance. Finally, the wonderful students who have turned up in such great numbers, not only from our department, but also from other colleges. Thank you so much for your cooperation. Once again, I thank all for your cordial cooperation. Thank you.
Thank you, Devadatta. I would like to request all the other students, all the other participants from other colleges to fill in the feedback form, which will be sent to you at the end of the session. Okay, by this, we have come to an end of the program. So once again, I thank everyone for being great listeners. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay, we can wind up the session. Thank you, Drishya.
Thank you, then. Bye.
Good.